Melinda done reached over the bacon, grabbed the knife, and about to slice Barney Fife. What in the Rakadushi is going on here? Now, this is what I'm talking about, Tyler. This is what I'm talking about. Now, this is a trailer. Let's get into it. Now, we already know that we've got clips from part one of season two fused in with some of the new scenes to lend more depth to the storylines, right? Y'all remember when Elder Mother made Melinda go into the trailer and bunk with Ruth to spy on her, right? And Ruth was straight chumping her off, right? Daikon threw up against the side of the trailer like he was a linebacker. This is that same night, right? Ruth is telling her about the escapees and told her that all they wanted to do was leave because Melinda thinks that the highest is nice and sweet and kind. But on this night, Ruth had to put her on game and let her know what was going on. But, you know, of course, Melinda didn't want to listen. Then we see Ruth and Tally out in the yard pulling out purple robes from the dirt. If we go back to the night after the highest killed the escapees, remember he ordered Daikon, I think it was Daikon, to bury the bodies on the grounds. And Elder Mother said that their dead bodies is good fertilizer for the grounds. The night that she really got mad at Ruth when she was giving him a mani-pedi, oh, she was big mad. Then we hear Lacey's voice saying they've got us trapped in here like animals. She was talking to Lacey and Zane after Elder Mother Agnes locked the door from the outside and trapped them inside their trailers. Ruth and Tally are standing in the kitchen when Ruth is telling her that they should do whatever they need to do to get out of there. And it's good to see them joining alliances to escape because they had planned to come up with their own way to escape, remember? When Ruth was getting greedy trying to get in on the plan with River and Joan. And that was a whole other mess, but this may be a clip that we have already seen. But either way, two heads are always better than one. Then we see the scene where Daikon was scolding Melinda for spying on him and Ruth. Then we cut to Clark holding Lacey and Daikon was about to hit her and Oliver said, oh no, 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 you ain't. Don't you hit my woman. He didn't really say that, but he did put a blocker move on Daikon real quick. Y'all know Oliver is ex-NFL, right? So Daikon better watch out. He better slow his roll. Then we see Lacey giving somebody a hug and she's crying. Now their back is turned, but from the side, it kind of looks like Paula and not sure. But you know, if you ask me, they got caught trying to leave, clearly. And in the overture, we hear Elder Mother's voice telling someone that they must follow the rules of the highest. And we know that Elder Mother don't play when it comes to the highest, so she's always by the book, always. Speaking of the highest, we see him sitting in his trailer, high as a kite. His skin looks all clammy, his eyes half open, half closed, slurring his words. Yeah, he lit. He said, so, you don't think this is paradise? No, but seriously, I want to make a reference here about Jim Jones because as time passed on the compound, Jim's dependency on drugs grew worse and worse as time went on. And when he and his followers initially arrived in Jonestown, there were several videotaped footages of members, you know, of the church saying how beautiful it was. And they saw beauty in more than one way because they carved out this heavily wooded area, like jungle-like, right? And they made it their own. They could grow their own food and they were like living without rules, right? No authority. So to them, that was beauty in itself. So I'm sure that this may have been where the term is coined from. And I did a whole video about it, actually. If you haven't seen it yet, I'll link it above and also in the description. Then we see Zane here telling Ruth and Tally that there is a car out back. Now, why no one else has seen this bright, shiny, orange, brown, rusty orange car is beyond me. But, you know, nonetheless, she lets them know that it's there. And Tally is intrigued and says, what car? Then we see Paula and Lacey ducking, trying to avoid being seen by Daikon. Then Paula can't crank the car up. And I knew it. I knew this was going to happen. But I thought that they all agreed that Lacey was going to be the one to drive the car because she was the one who was most familiar with the inside when Lilo took her away, you know, that night she went to go see the senators. Then they included the clip of Daikon running after Melinda to, I guess, to make it appear that he's running after the girls, maybe. But this is that night that he was running after her. Then the highest is seen telling someone that he has a prophecy. It may be Daikon. And if the highest has prophecies and premonitions and visions, I mean, he should be able to see his sidekick is banging Ruth, right? But no, I'm sure he's probably already figured that out. I'm just waiting to see what he's gonna do about it, right? That's what I want to know. Then we cut to Tally telling Oliver that they put drugs in the food. Then we see her sitting, watching Musty Yancey sip the soup. And she has a little smirk on her face. Now, I'm sure that this soup is laced with something that she prepared for him, right? More than likely with drugs in it. And Tally's probably taking a page out of Ruth's book, right? Trying to trick Musty Yancey into thinking that he got some so she can grab those keys. And at this point, Tally should be grabbing car keys or bus keys or truck keys. I mean, she can grab the keys to the four-wheeler because going to that trailer with the kids ain't enough. Like, that's not gonna cut it. Then we see River coming up with yet another scatterbrain plan, and Ruth said that they're all dead. Now, I don't know why Ruth even wastes her time talking to River, because River's plan was an epic fail. Everybody that left got murdered. So no words for you, bruh. None. Then we cut to Brian in his little cop car being Captain Save-A-Woe. Like I said in my last video, Brian knows better. Brian is well aware of David Koresh, Jim Jones. He knows all this because Mac told him before he even went on assignment. He said, "We don't want another massacre." You know, Brian knows this. And he know he should not be going alone. Jim Jones' followers committed a mass suicide, right? By drinking Kool-Aid. And Koresh's followers were in a standoff with the government and the FBI for days. Negotiating. People were dying left and right. And he's headed to the compound all alone. To do what? Brian needs to just stop. You know, literally, he needs to pump the brakes and rethink this whole entire thing. He gonna mess around and get everybody killed. Mm-hmm. Killed. Then Joan is seen telling Ruth that the cartel launders money through the compound, and River confirms that millions of dollars are being ran through the compound. And she poses the question of what will happen when the cartel comes looking for their money. Then it quickly cuts to the Highest, and he's squealing that they're gonna come here and kill us. I mean, he has fear in his voice, and we've never heard this voice tremble before with fear, right? He's the Highest. He can't be scared, but he may just be paranoid. Then we hear Tally saying four of the most deadliest words ever. She said, "We all want to leave. We all want to leave." I bet the Highest saying, "Yeah, we all gonna leave, all right." He said, "Did I not provide for you? Did I not give you paradise?" So now he guilt tripping. He wants them to all feel bad about wanting to leave. And I wonder who put Tally up to this. I mean, she's standing up here saying all of this to the Highest. They probably all voted her in and just put her up to it, because we all know that Tally was supposed to be an elder, right? But she brought shame to the Rakadushis because she stole Dale's mom and dad's truck. Remember that? But they quickly shifted the eldership to Ruth after she brought little Callie to the compound. Then we hear the Highest voice saying that you're going to be punished. Poor Tally. Tally didn't need no more punishments, right? No more beatings, no more humiliation. My goodness, poor Tally. Then we hear the Highest saying that somebody's gonna get cleansed. That's his favorite pastime, right? And it shows Andrew holding his hands in his face, but I'm not sure if he's exactly talking to him, because Andrew's already told us and Diacon that he will never go through that again. So this is gonna be interesting. Then Elder Mother is telling someone that it's time to prepare the punch. And I guess the adults will be drinking the punch and the kids will be eating the applesauce. And then we see Elder Mother Agnes toasting to the Highest, but this appears to be an old clip when her and Elder Mother were in the kitchen after hours sipping on the moonshine, aka the fermented applesauce. Then we see everybody under the gazebo chanting, "We are the Raku." And it looks like this may be one of Ruth's big tests that the Highest was talking about. Remember, after he and Ruth finished one of their rounds, he said that she will be tested to prove her loyalty to him. So I'm looking forward to this as well. Then it looks like Tally is beginning to fall apart. She tells Ruth that everyone there has been brainwashed and that she doesn't have anyone. And then Ruth reassures her that she has her. And again, this is really refreshing to see them working together, you know, and she's letting her know that she has her support and that she's got her back, because they're gonna need each other. Like, they really are. We see Daikon walking in on the Highest meditation session, and he tells him that they have a small issue. Then it cuts to Andrew telling Daikon that someone is plotting to kill the Highest. And I wonder who that is. I mean, he done pissed somebody off real bad, right? Then we see River telling Joan that the Highest is violent when he gets angry. We see him knocking Daikon off of his feet, literally. Now, this is the second time that he suckered Daikon, right? I wonder how many more times Big Bad Daikon is going to take these sucker punches from Tyrone. Then Jones says, this whole place will be violent. Then the highest says, I love the chaos. So again, we have old clips sprinkled in with the new scenes for the new season. But nonetheless, they spliced this together real good. It's real good. Now, some of the scenes that we see that didn't hold any dialogue, we saw Melinda putting her hands around her own neck while chatting with Andrew. Lacey's crying and sweating behind the trailer. Melinda is throwing herself at the feet of the highest, and Lacey's choking out Elder Mother in the punishment trailer. And last but not least, we see the shooter walking in on the lady in the shower. And that concludes our trailer breakdown. If you enjoyed this video, go ahead and give it a thumbs up. I'd really appreciate it. And while you're at it, go ahead and sub to the channel if you have not already done so. And don't forget to hit that bell icon so that you're reminded every time I drop a new video. Thank you so much for joining me on this episode of Ruthless TV, and I'll see you on the next one.